Hello, and welcome to our brief overview of self-care strategies to deal with moral distress and compassion fatigue. We're so glad you joined us. As the Elnick team, we wanted to be able to share with you some of our slides that we've used in our Elnick core curriculum for nurses who are providing palliative care, as we think many of our slides would be really helpful to those of you who are taking care of patients during the challenge of this coronavirus. So to begin, we want to emphasize the fact that to be able to really take care of yourself, we as nurses must come together and support each other and our colleagues. We're experiencing tremendous moral distress, compassion fatigue, burnout, from the challenges that we've been facing the past 4 weeks or so, with the escalating numbers of patients with COVID and those who are actively dying. We've recognized that the nurses desperately need help to be able to take care of themselves if they're going to be able to continue to take care of these patients and families that are struggling during this entire pandemic. What do we know? Well, we know that there are tremendous hazards in the helping professions. We know from our palliative care world that lots of emotional energy is spent taking care of patients who are experiencing physical suffering, emotional suffering, spiritual angst, and certainly needing end-of-life care. And as we witness those patients who are coming to the end of their life and the families that are grieving the loss, there's no question that tremendous amount of emotional energy is spent in those situations. And now, during this coronavirus pandemic, this is compounded. We're not only dealing with end-of-life, but we're dealing with a virus that is rampant across the country. We are scared as healthcare professionals because of the lack of PPE. We're putting ourselves and our family members at risk as we go out to take care of these patients. We're struggling emotionally with the problems with equity among treatment options, you know, certainly seeing some hotspots needing more equipment than maybe they're able to get. And we're also really struggling and suffering with interacting with families that are unable to be with their loved ones at end of life. That's something that we've never had to witness before, and we haven't had to come up with creative solutions to try to help those families deal with this ever before. And that is a tremendous amount of energy that's taking a toll on us as nurses in the helping profession. And so we ask questions about how are we getting by? How are we doing this? And are these hazards, you know, causing us to certainly experience compassion fatigue, burnout, moral distress, or, you know, all of the above? And for those of you who are wondering what compassion fatigue is, it's certainly this overwhelming sense of fatigue. It's physical, emotional, and spiritual, and it comes from continuous self-sacrifice and prolonged exposure to difficult situations, which is every bit what the coronavirus experience is now for those of you on the front lines. And as a result, we find it's really difficult to nurture, to care for, to love others, and to certainly empathize with others who are suffering. Burnout is a little different in that it's usually triggered by the workplace demands, which of course right now are huge. We're having to work with staffing limitations. Some of our own coworkers are getting sick, and so the patient to nurse workload is changing. Some of us are being even taken from our usual units of care and moved to other sites for clinical practice in areas that maybe we're not even familiar with. So huge workplace demands. And as we talked about earlier, lack of resources and organizational policies, including those about that we have to honor and respect in terms of safety, that really have caused us to have symptoms associated with burnout. And the pandemic is also contributing to moral distress. Moral distress is something that we suffer when we're having to act in a way that's in direct opposition to our own values and beliefs. And people are having to do this right now. You're being asked to be at the bedside when family members can't be with loved ones who are actively dying. You're asked to do what seems to be almost nearly impossible total care for these patients that are so sick, asking that you attend to their physical, psychological, social, and spiritual needs, often without other health care team members that often supported you, especially for psychological, social, or spiritual issues that maybe you felt you needed that team member to provide the level of care that the patient needs. Yet now you're being asked to be that interdisciplinary team yourself. And that may be very, very challenging, and certainly not the way we were used to practicing when we've been advocating that team is so important when you're taking care of patients with serious illness and their families. Other aspects that contribute to moral distress is witnessing unrelieved pain and certainly unrelieved suffering and angst. You're seeing patients struggling with being alone. You're witnessing family members struggling to not be able to be with their loved ones and really having a difficult time having to stay outside of the hospital or the long-term care setting with their loved ones alone in that facility. We're seeing certainly challenges with providing care with maybe you're continuing to have limited access to necessary equipment, reusing PPE more than you would normally do in other circumstances. And so you are under many, many stressors that contribute to the moral distress. But what's good news is that nurses have risen to this occasion. We are leaders, and we've been leaders during a crisis, whether it's Florence Nightingale during the Crimean War or all of us who are fighting this battle with coronavirus. We can be very flexible. We can be incredibly creative. And certainly, again, this year in 2020, the Gallup poll announced that nurses are the most trusted healthcare professionals and continue to be for, I think it's over 18 years or so now. We rise to the occasion because we have been prepared and educated in our schools of nursing to be strong advocates for patients, for families, for communities. And not only are we strong advocates, we're expert, compassionate clinicians who can actually do holistic care of mind, body, spirit, when we have to do it even alone without our other team members. And as you all know, it's often the nurses that are at the bedside the most, especially during this pandemic. Many other team members are not going in for a variety of reasons. And you are the ones that are 24/7 around the clock providing that care to patients and their loved ones. But we can't keep doing this if we don't take care of ourselves, especially during this pandemic. It's absolutely critical that you, take time to do self-care. And I'm sure you're wanting to say to me, are you crazy? I can barely keep my head above water. But you've got to find a way to take a moment, even if that's all it is, to make sure that you are taking care of yourself. So practice self-awareness. Be very proactive in being aware of your own body and what your body needs and taking care of yourself if you need to. Take a moment every day for some self-reflection. At the end of the day, think about, did I really do a good job taking care of myself? And, could I do a better job tomorrow when I go back to my clinical setting? And I'm going to do that. Strengthen your own sense of self-efficacy. Believe in yourself. You can do it. You are doing an amazing job in probably the most challenging circumstances we've seen in nearly a decade. I'm sorry, in nearly, 100 years since the last pandemic in the early 1900s. We've never experienced anything like this. And you're remarkable. We see it, the that calls out to you as heroes on the news every single day and in the newspapers, saying thank you for the great work you're doing. Try to practice body monitoring. Pay attention to your body's own messages. If you're hungry, stop. If you're thirsty, stop. Rehydrate. Take time to get the appropriate healthy calories and protein in and take a break. It's okay. In fact, it's more than okay. It's essential, or else we're going to lose you to this profession, and we don't want that to happen. Develop a wellness plan for yourself that's feasible in this hectic time. So maybe this isn't going to be the time that you can work out 5 days a week for 45 minutes at a time. You're juggling a heavy workload. You've got probably increased family care needs, whether it's with, you know, older adult family care members you're taking care of, or the children that are home being homeschooled. You're trying to feed everybody, take care of everybody, get the groceries in, get the toilet paper, all of those things that are overwhelming. Find a way to establish a healthy wellness plan that is feasible. Don't add stress to your already stressful situation by not being able to achieve something. And to deal with moral distress, we have to cultivate moral resilience. And that just means to be able to be buoyant in adverse circumstances. I see you doing this every single day as I, you know, gratefully listen to newscasters talk about how amazing nurses are. And we do know how to do this. We've been prepared to do this. And we know how to look for meaning in despair. That's a way to be morally resilient in this difficult time. Can you recall and focus on at least one bright moment that happened during the day that made you grateful? Look for that meaning in your experience of the day. Maybe another colleague supported you when you were making a difficult decision, and you were so grateful for that colleague's support. Maybe a family member told you how much they appreciate that you help that FaceTime chat with them. Or what, look outside your window. Many, many local communities are putting on parades to cheer on the healthcare workers that are doing a great job, and they're doing it right outside your window in your institutions, or posting signs outside your window saying thank you. Look for that meaning. That's one way to keep going. Another way is knowledge. Keep up with the evidence-based facts. Now, that doesn't mean I want you to go listening to all the news, because that can be overwhelming, but there are so many myths circulating. You want to be able to have access to strong websites that have the latest facts, the latest updates, and that are accurate and evidence-based. And we've listed those for you, and we give you even more resources at the end of this slide presentation. And another way to gain knowledge that makes you feel even more powerful and able to overcome these hard circumstances is, if you're not comfortable with providing primary palliative care, to try to learn more about it. LNIC is online. It can give you the knowledge you need, especially if you're not familiar with taking care of patients who are actively dying. Even listening to a module on final hours might give you the education you need to be able to take care of patients as you are dealing with multiple deaths on your particular unit. Or maybe you found that you really need some additional help dealing with loss, grief, and bereavement. We have LNIC online available to you to give you the words and the help and the support so that you can get through this. We've also put these slide presentations up on our LNIC site. These are totally free, and hopefully these little snippets from our larger LNIC online are giving you the strength that you need to move forward, and the knowledge that you need to give you the power to be able to do it. So many nurses, we've heard from many people saying, what do I do if I'm struggling? How do I lead the way? Well, ordinarily, we encourage you to utilize your employee health counselors for personal support, but we also recognize that, you know, they may not be easily accessible during this crisis. I know that some institutions are even limiting the number of people who are working in the hospitals to, again, keep the spread of the disease down. But if you don't have those employee health counselors available to you, seek out a nurse colleague to debrief with. Being able to talk it through can make a big difference if you're struggling. And if you're seeing ethical dilemmas, if you're seeing ethical issues that are taking a toll on you and causing moral distress, talk with your supervisor and your colleagues. Maybe you don't have access to an ethics committee member at this time during this crisis, but you have to be heard. Your voice has to be loud and strong. We are used to being advocates, and we can't keep that inside of us. So, you know, raise the issues, talk about them, get them out there. You need to be heard. And then certainly if there are staffing issues that, you know, are contributing to your workload stress, talk about them with your supervisor and your colleagues. I have been so impressed with hearing stories about many nurse colleagues who recognize that some of their fellow workers are really at great risk for contracting the virus and becoming very seriously ill with it. Those who have multiple comorbidities or might be much older than some of the other colleagues on the unit. And they've really stepped up to the plate and say, those people who I know are immune compromised or at great risk for contracting the virus should have limited contact with these patients who we know are COVID positive. And it makes me so proud of my profession to hear those stories of nurses saying, you know, we want to look out for our own. What else can you do if you're struggling? Celebrate successes and joys. We're hearing about the people that are recovering from this illness, and we want to hear more about that, not just about those who are dying. So in the midst of this pandemic, there's always joy to be found. Do you have a bulletin board, or do you post things up in the bathroom where everybody can see it? Put up those thank you messages to each other, or spiritual words of support, phrases that give you strength, things to keep each other going. That will definitely spark joy and everyone amidst the struggles that you're witnessing. And certainly if you're experiencing any incivility or bullying in the workplace, any violence or issues that, you know, we know our own American Nurses Association takes a very strong stand against that, look at the resource section that we've listed for you and ways to address that if you're seeing some of that. Fortunately, we're hearing more good stories in the workplace than negative ones, and I hope that's continuing in your own place of work. But if there are struggles due to people really at the height of stress, please use our resources that are there for you to help address the incivility that you might be witnessing or experiencing. Other things to help you address compassion fatigue and burnout and moral distress. Maybe somebody on your unit can be that wellness champion. Maybe you don't feel like you can take that on, but somebody else is a great leader. And call that person out to see if that particular nurse can be helpful to remind others to take care of themselves. You need a wellness champion. Take a moment, maybe at the start of each shift on the unit that you're at, to come together, you know, again, socially distancing, you can't do what we used to do, but a moment of self-reflection, a word of the day, something that brings everyone together in spirit and emotionally, even though we're physically apart, is really important. And starting the day or your shift off with that sets the tone that hopefully will give you some strength as you move forward. And then keep in mind that you have to take breaks, go to the bathroom. Nurses are so bad at honoring and respecting the needs of their own bodies, and find a way to make sure that there's nutritious food available. You know, eating is such a social expression of caring in our culture, and maybe single package items that everyone can enjoy will bring some joy to your unit that tomorrow, if you can think of ways to do that. Protect yourself through this crisis. try to maintain a positive, proactive self-care attitude. And I don't think any of you would be surprised about what's in, encompasses that proactive self-care. I'm sure most of you are saying, I'm really struggling with getting quality sleep. I'm struggling with my, I don't have my old exercise plan anymore because I'm working overtime, or, I'm doing more work at home than I used to. And I've got so much responsibility in my own family now that's even more than usual. How do you expect me to be able to be proactive? Again, be positive. Find something that you can do to improve your own self-care every day that's feasible and realistic, and pay attention to your body's signals and respond to those needs. One of the things that help positive emotions is at the end of the day, just write down two or three things that went really well during the day. It's so helpful to see those in writing. We can be bogged down by all the things that we think didn't go well, and we forget that often there are many, many more positive things than negative, and yet we don't focus on them. Force yourself to do that at the end of each day. And as I said earlier, it's so important to start each day positively on your unit with maybe some sort of a reflection. But for yourself, start each day with an affirmation, an attention, I statement that gets you ready to be that positive, proactive person. For example, telling yourself, I will provide compassionate care today to those who are dying. We might not be able to stop death, but we are very able to provide that compassionate care. And so reminding yourself positively of what you are bringing to that patient who is so alone in that room, and how much you are bringing to that family who feels so isolated from their loved one. And the only communication they have is with your support and your help, whether it's by cell phone or laptop, FaceTime, or the call that gives them the update. Thank yourself for the great work that you're doing, and express gratitude for the good things that you've witnessed around you. Your mental health is every bit as important as your physical health. And we know that we're all struggling with being so cooped up in this time of social distancing. Try to stay connected to your own family and friends. Utilize the technology with that. You're probably not able to go out as you have in the past, maybe with some of your colleagues, but you've got to find a way with technology to still stay connected. Help others. That can always make you feel mentally so much more healthy. So reaching out to elders or others in need in your own community. Find a creative way to get together with some friends maybe once a week. You don't have your book club or your knitting group or whatever gym group that you belong to. Try to substitute videos or Zoom activities that allow you to still stay connected, and access some of the great opportunities online to participate in church services or prayer groups if those have brought you strength in the past. Thank goodness it's spring, at least it is on the East Coast, and hopefully you're all experiencing it to some extent across the country. Take a moment to go outside and just soak up that fresh air and look at the blooms that are happening before us. There is hope, and there is renewal, and there is rebirth, and we are going to get through this. Keep in mind that it's not selfish to be taking care of yourself. In fact, it's never been more important than it is now. If you don't take good care of yourself, you can't take care of others. And we are so good at telling family members that all the time. We educate our and support our family members, encouraging them to take care of themselves when they're caring for a loved one. Yet it's ironic that we don't always do that for ourselves. So you've got to do that so we don't lose you. We don't want you to burn out. We want you to be able to respond to the needs that you have, as well as your families, your patients, and your colleagues in the community. And if you don't find a few sacred minutes every day to do something for yourself, you won't be able to continue at this level. I know one of the things I've heard from a couple of people is even with our 20-second hand washing, which we are doing so frequently, taking a moment to do that positive affirmation or to think about something that you're grateful for, that will give you strength and boost your positive emotions to help get you through this. Again, on behalf of Elnick, we thank you all for what you're doing for patients, for families, for your communities. We're so proud to be part of this nursing profession, and very grateful for the amazing work that you are doing. Take care of yourself. Stay safe, stay healthy, and find meaning in these challenging times. What we've left for you on the next couple of slides are the references that we've cited, but in addition, the resources with links to helping you in terms of bullying and well-being. Please access those as you see appropriate to your health. Thank you and goodbye.